The following is a Fox 45 News special.
Good evening. I'm Steve Marks, general manager of WBFF-TV Fox 45. Join us for the next hour as Fox 45 News takes you on an unusual journey to Ecuador in South America. Recently, Fox 45 News at 10 anchor Lisa Willis got the rare opportunity to travel with a group of Maryland doctors who volunteer their time and talent to help children in need. It's an emotional trip to a place where American doctors are welcomed as heroes and luxuries like quality health care are not taken for granted. Fox 45 News is committed to finding stories of Marylanders working to help solve problems here at home and a world away in places like Ecuador. Join us now for Mending Broken Hearts, Fixing Broken Smiles.
As the sun sets on another day in Baltimore, little has changed in Charm City. The winter of 95 was a mild one, but as usual, too long for many of us. And Marylanders are anxious for summer's return. But 2,500 miles due south of here, winter is fast approaching. South of the equator, a world away, in the country of Ecuador, the people aren't as charged with the promise of a new season. Below the dividing line, not only are the seasons reversed, but time there has failed to catch up with the rest of the modern world. There, the rainy season has begun, and soon begins the healing season. In a matter of hours, news spreads of a coming visit from a group of medical specialists from America. Soon, several dozen doctors, dentists, nurses, and assistants will travel to Ecuador on a mission to change lives and renew hopes. We're about to take you on a journey back in time, 50 years, or so it would seem, when you see Ecuador and you meet the people. Things we take for granted, like hot water, cheeseburgers, emergency medical services, are virtually non-existent there, which is why this is such a remarkable trek. The Americans, most of whom are from the Baltimore area, will use their own money for travel. They'll talk local companies into donating medical supplies and toys. For some, this is their spring vacation. But their goal is simple: treat as many villagers as they can, given the primitive conditions they'll be encountering in a very limited amount of time. Join us for Fixing Broken Smiles next.
You're watching a Fox 45 News special, Mending Broken Hearts, Fixing Broken Smiles.
Oh, it does?
It's Wednesday, and on the third Wednesday of every month, something unusual happens in this office. The doctors come visit the patients.
How you doing? I think I remember this young lady.
On the fourth floor of a downtown Baltimore office building, a group of doctors from the University of Maryland Medical Center clear their busy schedules to see patients who require more attention than most.
It's like a little turbinate work, but you can see all the way back otherwise.
This team of oral and maxillofacial surgeons, ophthalmologists, and other specialists work in stations consulting patients who need repeated surgery to correct a multitude of deformities.
It's oftentimes refreshing, I think, for these people to hear it from a little bit different viewpoint. And then to sit down around a table and discuss the problems and put together a treatment plan that may span 12 or 15 years.
Dr. Bruce Horswell stops by in between scheduled surgery.
By the flow.
And Dr. Brian Flowers checks a young girl's hearing.
No Q-tips, no?
No.
Okay.
You're an excellent student, as I recall. Isn't she a good student?
She's very deft, and she got her first B this year.
Oh, dear. Well, you can join the rest of us high Bs then.
Horswell's fondness for children shows. As a father of four, he is well aware of the fear children experience in unfamiliar surroundings.
See those third molars way up there coming in?
Horswell and the rest of the troop try to make right what genetics or a tragic accident has made wrong, sometimes rearranging a patient's entire face, breaking and grafting bones, moving tissue, and replacing skin. Renee Benjamin is a longtime patient who has undergone a number of operations to correct a genetic deformity. But she's full of advice for other young children facing the same kind of surgery.
I would say not to worry because it's going to be okay.
You see these kids and you see their problems and you see them after perhaps a series of two or three procedures look pretty normal, and they're pretty happy, and that's pretty gratifying.
It's like you're sleeping in bed. Okay, here we go. Whee! How old are you, Carly?
While the issue of health care and insurance coverage continues to make headlines, there is no doubt that medicine is moving forward. New advances in technology make it possible for a pain-free dental visit. And dentists like Dr. Parry Moazzid welcome the smiles instead of the tears.
Bite down for me. Okay. Do you see the overlap?
Well, I think she does the same thing I did as a child, that tongue thrust every single time you swallow.
As Americans demand better medical care, doctors, dentists, and researchers struggle to accommodate them, even if it's not polished to perfection. When compared to many other nations, the American healthcare system works, and it works well.
There's not enough tooth structure to completely restore the tooth.
Dr. Moazzid has seen a different side of dental care. Last year, she traveled with a group of professionals to Ecuador to offer her services as a dentist to hundreds of poor children and adults in the villages of the Amazon.
I've always liked the idea of going to an underprivileged area and providing some kind of care. And I guess it's made, reaffirmed my reasons for becoming a dentist, to help people.
In just a few short days, she'll make the journey again, giving up her spring vacation to lend a helping hand. Myra is a bright six-year-old who could be considered one of the luckiest girls in the world. Full of life and promise, Myra was a victim of a broken smile. When she arrived to Baltimore from her native Ecuador last year, Myra was physically incapable of a grin. Born with a severe birth defect, Myra was abandoned by her parents because of her deformity. Dr. Bruce Horswell first met Myra last year in South America on a journey to help children and adults with a condition similar to Myra's.
She was brought in by the farm manager and just wondered if we could do something for her. Now, she had been born with this deformity that there's a defect in the skull between the eyes and her brain had pushed through.
The condition was life-threatening. But more importantly to Myra, she wanted to look like the other children.
Before, she was very intimidated. She was very apprehensive. I think she didn't have any self-confidence. And she was very timid with people because probably she was isolated there in Ecuador and her place. Maybe she never intermingled with the children and people because of her deformity.
It was Tammy Fesch, a Baltimore developer, who organized the group Ecuadent, which helped bring Myra to the United States. Every year, Tammy puts out a call for the best and brightest volunteers to make a 2,500-mile trek to Ecuador to help the villagers. As a native of South America, the project is heartfelt.
This will be one opportunity in their life that they will, it's like a gift from God, practically, because if we don't provide the service for them, they will be untreated and they will be in pain or miserable in some of the cases.
This was Myra before surgery. And Myra today.
I think from her operations, from the concern shown to her, the care that people have demonstrated, and in just having a good time here in the States for a six-year-old. And she's, I think, enjoyed herself, and she's rediscovered or discovered a part of herself. Perhaps it wasn't there.
It's a wonderful satisfaction that she has come along this way. When I remember when she was very sick and she was in intensive care, and I do feel a lot of emotion because on one hand, I feel happy for her that she's doing well, but also I am gonna be very sad when she leaves. It's gonna hurt me a lot.
When the time finally arrives for Myra to return home, it was just as Tammy had predicted. She will return to her native land, a changed young lady. It won't be long before the doctors travel back to Ecuador in search of another Myra. And there will probably be another goodbye as emotional as this one.
And she tells me, you know, when I bathe her and change her and comb her hair, she tells me how beautiful she is. And I say, yes, Mayra, you are beautiful.
Mayrita, adios.
Mending broken hearts, fixing broken smiles will continue. Now back to Mending Broken Hearts, Fixing Broken Smiles.
After months of planning, weeks of meetings, and hundreds of phone calls, this year's Ecuadent group is charged and ready to leave Baltimore behind.
Hey, you monkey.
There are 34 men and women and nearly 100 pieces of luggage. The volunteers come with their own supplies, their own medical equipment, and of course a treasure chest filled with toys to give to the children in Ecuador. The journey is a long one. Leaving Baltimore, they transfer planes in Houston, and then make a stop in Panama City, Panama, before arriving 13 hours later in Quito, Ecuador. Under cover of darkness, the group arrives in the second highest capital city in the world, Quito, Ecuador. A bevy of fatigue-clad soldiers offer a shield of safety in a country which is essentially at war with its Peruvian neighbors, while the front line of the border skirmish lies 100 miles to the east and south, there is still the threat of terrorism, and the soldiers are careful to ensure the group's safety. Darkness masks the beauty of Ecuador, and not until the next day does it become apparent just how beautiful this country really is. Ecuador is named for the imaginary line which divides our planet into two hemispheres, north and south. Snow-capped mountains rise from the Pacific Ocean, thrusting deserts and jungles high into the clouds. To the west, deep gorges are scraped from the majestic peaks, carrying daily rains to the thick canopy of the Amazon rainforest below. Because Ecuador lies on the equator, many people think the climate is infernally hot. However, in spite of its small size, about as big as Arizona, Ecuador possesses a variety of climates and very few extremes, only noticeably wet and dry seasons. Before the 12-hour trip into the jungle, where the doctors and nurses will offer their services, the group takes a tour of the ancient city.
We're gonna walk around over here and then we're gonna go up.
Besides the lofty snow-capped mountains which surround the city, the most prominent feature, the city's churches. In the center of Old Town Quito is Santo Domingo Square. It's in the shadow of the Church of Santo Domingo. It's a reminder of how important the Catholic religion is to the people of Ecuador. And smiling down on them on any given day is the statue of the Virgin Mary. The people are friendly. They are very hard workers, carrying out seemingly impossible tasks. And they are very creative, concocting a myriad of trinkets and wearable goods for tourists and natives to buy. But there are some things better left alone.
It's real with marbles in its eyes.
The political pendulum swings constant in this land, from liberal to conservative, civilian to military rule, from dictatorship to democracy. A democratically elected president holds office behind these walls. But his job is a difficult one, for this is a tumultuous country. In the square right here in front of the presidential palace, thousands of protesters had gathered because they were upset about the border war between Ecuador and Peru. It was over land and oil rights. But in the past few weeks, the dispute has been settled and everything is back to normal. The square is once again at peace. But the peace would not last long. And Ecuadorian reporters press political leaders for answers. The government says their requests for aid from the rest of the world fall on deaf ears. But this time, their cries for help are heard by this group of doctors from a world away, and they are grateful.
He appreciates very much all the assistance and that sometimes if this country right here cannot do it, and we are, the Americans are able to do it at least once a year.
What would Ecuadorians want the Americans to know about the state of the country when it comes to health care right now?
It's very difficult to cover and give services to the whole country, and that's why it appreciates a lot the help of the Americans.
¿Cuántos años tienes?
On the eve of the trek into the Amazon, a very special ceremony takes place, an event even covered by South American television stations. The Ecuadorian army has been watching over little Myra since she left Baltimore with a new smile several weeks ago. She's been away for many months, and the reunion is bittersweet. The women, now in charge of raising Myra, have traveled a great distance to take her home. Their tears show how much she is missed. But the bond of love she has for the people who cared for her in Baltimore remains, and probably will always be there. After years of being taunted and teased because of how she once looked, Myra is going home to a new life. Those who knew Myra before the operation are equally thankful for the work Ecuadent has done.
We hope this thing continue to help all the people in our country. Thank you very much. I don't have words to thank you for everything you have done for here.
The Army General offers his gratitude to those who helped Myra, saying, "It is best to give the thanks to God, for he is the one who sent you to us."
It's yours.
You're watching a Fox 45 News special, Mending Broken Hearts, Fixing Broken Smiles.
Oh, there's the waterfall.
Whoa, look at that.
A new day brings new challenges. Just getting to the destination will be an adventure.
Oh, my God.
This was last inspected in 1946.
The music playing on the radio fits the mood. Exciting and daring.
Please stop the bus. Please stop the bus.
A few moments ago, we just entered into the Amazon region, and without a doubt, it's better than any ride at Disney World. Because while we're on this journey, there's always the possibility of falling 1,000 feet to the water below.
Under Army escort, the volunteers leave the mountain region of Ecuador and journey into the Amazon. Some have nicknamed the area the Valley of Death, for around every corner, there is the element of surprise and danger. Buses travel on the frail dirt road like they were paved interstates. Deadly accidents are a daily occurrence. There are two things to do on this trip. Sightsee.
One more, because I want something to take home with me.
And sleep. This mission is also a learning experience. A visit to a town along the way gives a whole new meaning to the word bargain hunting. The Altavalo Indians have practically turned their entire town into an outdoor market, selling clothing and trinkets, food and drink. The sight of a grilled guinea pig is amusing, but no one on this trip ventures a try. This is an opportunity to meet and discover more about the people they'll be treating.
Different Indians that wear different hats, and you're going to see a lot of different hats here.
That determines the different tribes?
Exactly. You can tell pretty much with the regions where they come from. Also, you're going to see a lot of the Otavalo Indians, the women that wear this jewelry in the neck. The higher it gets and you cannot move your neck, the wealthier you are.
The people are as breathtaking as the land. One of the last stops before reaching the hospital is Crater Lake, a grand vista high atop a mountain where the wind blows cool and constantly. A breath of fresh air before the hurried week ahead. The long journey comes to a bumpy end on a cobblestone road in the Pastaza province of Ecuador. This is Puyo, a town that sits on the windowsill of the Amazon jungle. Workers at the Army hospital welcome the group with open arms. And as is customary in Ecuador, moments like these are marked by official ceremonies. Efforts like this hardly go unnoticed.
Hemos logrado que el grupo
this program that they had the opportunity to include Ecuadent into the program and also to try to help all the people in this area which don't really have too much money to pay for a doctor.
What kind of help is he looking for in the future? Is it something that he hopes will grow, the programs will continue to grow just like Ecuadent?
Sí, aparte del...
He says that this program is really going to grow bigger and bigger. But more important that not only in the medical field, but only in the education, They also want to educate all the people in this area, because with education, everything will be better, you know, and financially and economically.
Severe deformity of the jaw, I will see. Yeah.
There is little daylight left, so efforts turn immediately to helping the people who have gathered outside.
No, right here.
The pace is fast and frantic.
You want to get everything from that thing is going to be pulled in here in about the next 5 minutes.
Some of these villagers have traveled more than 100 miles to be seen by the American doctors. A compound under heavy guard separates those who want help and those who are here to help.
Obviously, we'll talk with the primary people first.
When the gates open, people flood the courtyard. Those with the most severe medical conditions will be seen first. Understandably and sadly, not everyone will be treated. But everyone will be seen.
She hopes that if the American doctors can see her and treat her and cure or fix that lip, in that case, that lady will be happier and she's going to be able to eat better and she's going to be beautiful.
Their faces show telltale signs of cleft lip and cleft palates, a very common disorder in the region. It's thought to be a genetic birth defect. Doctors now think may be linked to smoking during pregnancy. There are few smiles today.
And over in this room, the surgeons are going to triage the patients, and they will rate them 1, 2, and 3. 1 is urgent and will be done first. 2 will come next, and 3, if they have time, will be done.
Baltimore oral surgeon David Hassan is an Ecuadent veteran. This is his 6th trip.
Each time is a new experience, new challenges. We don't know exactly how many children are going to be seen tomorrow. We'll start and try to get at least 4 or 5 dental chairs going at one time so we can see as many children as possible. We have 9 dentists here, so everybody's willing to pitch in and get it done.
Tissue from the lower lip.
After waiting outside for more than 10 hours, the mother first in line with her young daughter Danielle is given disappointing news.
We all do not feel that it's appropriate to do surgery on the nose at this young age.
Danielle's mother would remain until midnight, hoping they change their mind. They do not. But the next little boy to sit down gets better news.
So Brian, why don't we just put him on as a number one and tell him what we're planning on doing is just making it so that he can speak better. We can't make miracles, but we hopefully will be able to make him talk better.
While some of the children show little emotion, others are terrified. A fear of the unknown is universal. The tears in this case work to the doctor's advantage, since all they wanted to do was see inside her mouth. One of the soldiers turns to the American doctors for help. His son is not like the other boys, and he hopes something can be done to change that. They explain his child is a victim of Down syndrome, and there is nothing they can do for him, even in the United States. Looking better is not always a priority to the patients here. A disfiguring accident or previous surgery that never healed properly can cause lifelong complications.
He says that it's hard for him to talk, and he cannot pronounce the words properly.
Right.
And that's what he wants to get better on.
Right.
And part of our frustration here is that we can't help every child to speak better. But if you ask most of these kids, this is a classic case. If we ask him if he can have one or the other, he can either look better or he can have his speech back. Which would he choose?
Indeed, the boy chooses his speech. As night falls, so does the rain. But the storm is of no surprise. This is the rainy season. The frustration of dealing with unfamiliar surroundings hits home.
Francisco Charco, C-H-A-R-C-O.
C-H what now?
This truly is a sign of things to come as the group begins to experience the primitive conditions they'll be working under. But frustration quickly turns to hope as the doctors meet a young girl they believe they can help. This 12-year-old from a nearby town was injured as a baby and was never treated properly. But now, talk turns to bringing her to the United States for a series of complicated surgeries to correct the problem.
What we would do is probably cut out the areas where the bone is frozen shut, put in ribs in there for her functioning joints, and bring her lower jaw forward So she'd be able to open her mouth, use her mouth, and make her look more symmetrical.
How real of a possibility is it for her to actually come to the United States? Is it something just formality and it could be several months?
She's one of the, in the next year.
The young girl's mother is excited about the prospect.
She said she would be, that would be wonderful, and she would thank God. She says that she would feel happy because she would be able to open her mouth and smile.
But doctors are very optimistic that she'll be able to travel to Baltimore for surgery she can't receive here. The first phase, triage, is just about ending. And when we come back, the work to repair smiles begins. Stay with us.
Mending broken hearts, fixing broken smiles will continue. Now back to Mending Broken Hearts, Fixing Broken Smiles.
Donned in surgical scrubs, the volunteers are ready for their first day of work. Every morning for the next 5 days, they will meet at the break of day to board a bus that will take them to the hospital. All the important tools are packed and ready to ride.
What do you got stuck in your
ear? It has a slinky in it.
That's wild.
Make it work. How do you do it? Is this what you do with the kids?
Yeah.
Well, how do you do it?
You just, si, senor.
Like, say real.
Mm-hmm.
They won't be back to their hotel for 12 hours. A barking dog breaks the morning silence. The day begins.
Pretty much the same, yeah. It's just getting used to where things are and how to
get. From this moment on, there will not be a silent moment. For the rest of the day, the doctors keep interpreters close at hand. For without clear lines of communication, little can be achieved.
Marco, por favor.
I make sure that everything goes fine and we got the right person and what's the problem with the patient.
Back home, Marco Avila is a highway engineer, but he was born in Quito.
This makes it really special because, in a way, I'm helping my own people.
Todo lindo.
This is Cecilia Benacasser's second journey with Ecuadent as interpreter and medical assistant. In Maryland, she is a critical care nurse at Greater Baltimore Medical Center.
Cierra los ojos.
She, too, was born in Ecuador.
Well, I said my people should learn from them because we are a little bit different, you know. And I was so grateful that I could help these people from my country. Mm-hmm. And that's why I come back this time, because I wanted to do the same thing.
Cecilia says the hardest part of her job is having to turn some patients away.
See, that's break my heart. Like just now, we were interviewing two mothers with two kids that they want to see the little kids, and we couldn't fill our schedule because it's full. But the doctors are telling me to tell them that to wait.
And they wait, by the dozens, in the hallways. And outside the surgical suite, at a window reminiscent of a fast food drive-thru, someone pens a sign which has little meaning to those who cannot read English. A bit of humor breaks the tense moments.
There you go.
But the laughter doesn't last long. Nearby, a mother has traveled from a tribe deep in the jungle in hopes of seeing her child healed.
She has a benign congenital tumor, and it needs to be operated on now, as soon as possible.
It's an operation that can only take place in the United States, but the Ecuadorian doctors want to believe the mother's trip was not in vain. They hope someone in the U.S. will hear her plea for help. Across the hall, surgery begins. Laura is one of the first patients. She is here to receive something she was born without, an ear. This is an emotional experience for any five-year-old, and the fear is compounded by the fact that just about everyone around her is speaking a language she does not understand.
I'm gonna tickle you to sleep.
University of Maryland anesthesiologist Elizabeth Lee convinces Laura the medicine tastes like grapes. The ploy works, and Laura goes under fast. For the next several hours, the team will work on carving out a portion of the little girl's ribs and creating the skeleton of an ear that will fit into the tissue clumped on the side of her head. The procedure is called microtia. a surgery performed frequently in Baltimore, but never here.
Today is really what I call our shakedown cruise. We come, we don't know exactly what equipment we have, and today is the day we figure out what we have works and what they have works and try to figure out what equipment we can use.
Right away, they discover the air conditioning doesn't work. Then they find out there is no air conditioning. The temperature has risen to 90 degrees, and there are no windows. Another setback, the surgical lamp above the table burns out, a crucial piece of equipment. Assistants grab the only other available light. It holds a 40-watt bulb. But not a complaint is uttered. This was expected. Nevertheless, such trying conditions take their toll.
It gets easier technically, but I think in reality we're very sad to leave, and as the week goes on, we find ourselves moving quickly as well, trying to squeeze in all the kids that we'd like to do that might not have time for otherwise.
Whoa.
When the stitches are gone and the bandages are removed, Lara will have a gift to last a lifetime, and her smile will light up her face from ear to ear. For the past 4.5 hours, the doctors and nurses have been working nonstop seeing patients. Right now they're working on 3 and 4, and there are still 4 more patients to be seen before the end of the evening. When we come back, we'll take you across the street to something else that's happening over there that's just as important. Stay with us.
Mending broken hearts, fixing broken smiles will continue. Now back to Mending Broken Hearts, Fixing Broken Smiles.
On the fourth day of work, dentists Wendy Brown and David Hassan greet a group of children that have traveled by bus from a nearby school.
How y'all doing? Buenos dias.
Good morning.
Good morning.
All right.
In English, yeah. Who can speak English here?
On the front steps of the hospital, the students line up for a brief outdoor dental visit. Since there's little space inside, the dentists are left with this makeshift examination room. This is the overflow area. But back at dental headquarters, no time is wasted treating the hundreds of patients lined up outside.
Over here is the extraction area. A lot of people have lined up to come and sit down here to have their teeth pulled. Once that happens, everybody gets a pencil, and they also get a toothbrush. The pencils seem to be a little bit more popular, but the dentists wish that they would walk out with a toothbrush anyway. Over here is the sterilization area. It may be a primitive environment, but making sure that everything is clean is paramount in this case. Following over here, the dental hygienists start their work cleaning people's teeth. They wind up having to pull off plaque from teeth that has been built up over a number of years. These people do not have dental care in the villages where they live. And finally, the dentists and the oral surgeons work on people filling teeth. They're also performing oral surgery. Now, all of this takes place in one room, where back in America, this would be just a small portion of one office.
The most commonly performed procedure on this trip, removing teeth.
Terminado.
This is Dr. Perry Moazid's second trip to Ecuador. The children she's seeing today are not that much different than those who come to our office in Westminster.
¿Cómo te llamas?
Silvia.
Silvia, mucho gusto.
Some of these children will have as many as 3 teeth pulled in just one sitting.
Sugar cane is very common here, and that causes a lot of cavities. And unfortunately, they get large and they can't be repaired.
The corridors of the hospital across the way are jam-packed with numerous patients waiting for someone to take the pain away.
From New York to LA.
Dr. Jack Hankel uses music to set the mood, and Senor Rocky, Hankel's fur-covered slinky, to set the children at ease.
We're only here for a while, so why not smile? Ain't living
it all that fast,
give me
one more shot.
I think they're all apprehensive, but these children are very stoic, and they sit still much better than American children.
Hankel is a York, Pennsylvania oral surgeon who has a wonderful disposition with young patients.
Gracias.
In an adjoining room, Dr. Hassan, a Mount Airy pediatric dentist, works on another young girl who has a mouthful of tooth decay, the result of poor dental hygiene.
It's not that it's not a priority, it's just that there's no preventive education the way we know preventive education. In the States, there's so much preventive education that we don't even
No dwelling?
Duele?
She has never learned about flossing or using fluoride or the importance of brushing her teeth. And that lack of knowledge will cost her two teeth today. Sadly, it's just the beginning for this 7-year-old who, like the other children in the region, consume an abundance of sugar and candy. Sugar substitutes do not exist in this country. After all, Ecuador is where the candy-coated gum chiclets are made. Hassan expects she'll lose many more teeth in her lifetime. This mission is not only aimed at healing, but preventing. The dentists come armed with hundreds of toothbrushes to give away. They can only hope the children put them to good use. The war on tooth decay is something they cannot run away from. Back in the hospital, waiting patiently for her turn, is a mother holding a child wrapped like a cocoon in blankets. The medical doctors conclude this birth defect is too profound for treatment here, but the dentist may be able to help.
We'll make something up.
Yes?
Not long after Dr. Stuart Shear begins work on an appliance for the boy's mouth, he discovers something very surprising about his newest patient.
Everyone said that he's very intelligent, more intelligent than normal.
His name is Luis, and he's 9 years old, and he can understand everything said to him. The birth defect has stunted his growth and has caused a myriad of other problems. Instead of drinking water from a glass, he pours by the spoonful, an accomplishment that amazes everyone in the room.
She wants him to study something in school, but right now there are no schools, special schools that are out there.
But he's learned a lot, so she's spent a lot of time teaching him.
If he can just learn to talk better, his mother believes that will help him learn. Dr. Shear plans on creating an appliance that will give him front teeth and will stop food from making its way through the hole in the roof of his mouth that causes him to choke. Making the appliance is easy. Getting Luis to wear it is another matter. They'll try again later. Luis and his mom become part of the scenery here for 2.5 days. Luis is now a friend. He is no longer viewed as a child with a severe handicap. He is a boy with spunk and determination. Unfortunately, that persistence works to the doctor's disadvantage. They finally give up. Luis will not wear the new device.
You know, it's nice to have success all the time, but I think sometimes success comes in different ways. And our contribution to him may be that he may feel a little bit more human as a result of all the interaction, you know, the last couple of days. And that may be one of the greatest gifts that we can give to Luis, more than just an appliance. It's much more than that, as I think most of this is. So, no, I don't feel sad.
Nevertheless, the experience is emotionally draining. The reflective moment doesn't last long, for there are still two more cases to see. One young boy who has been teased and taunted because of his cleft lip and missing teeth will walk away with a new smile, and his mother is thrilled.
She's so happy. She's very emotional right now. She never imagined that it was possible.
This makes it all worth it. Look how she's got tears of joy and tears of pain, and there's enough of that around here. So, you know, we've made a difference in this boy's life.
Don't put it in here.
And this boy's life is about to change as well. Miguel is about to see his mended smile in the mirror for the first time.
She says it's very beautiful.
Sit up a little bit. Smile.
Should I show
All right.
Him? Should I show him here?
Yeah, no, he hasn't seen it yet, so
okay.
Go ahead. You can
I'm
going to
put
him.
It right. Look. Right.
Look.
Get big.
Anyone can make a child smile. Few can give a child a smile. Miguel has made two new friends. The Ecuadorian Dr. Pablo, who helped give him a reason to smile, and Dr. Shear, who gave him a moment to remember for the rest of his life.
Now back to Mending Broken Hearts, Fixing Broken Smiles.
The last day of Fixing Broken Smiles in Puyo begins on a thunderous note. It could be considered a sign of things to come. The rain slows the pace, but it doesn't stop the villagers from lining up for a last chance to be treated. A few more patients with less serious maladies are wheeled in for surgery, but time is running out. Slumped against the wall of the OR, the list of accomplishments, names of those who will walk away with a new outlook on life. As surgery winds down in the operating room, there is news of incoming wounded. The realities of a tumultuous region strike home. An Ecuadorian soldier has stepped on a landmine near the border of Peru. The injury is serious enough to transport him by helicopter to the Pastaza province. An army ambulance brings him from the airport. It's a tense moment. Some are viewing this as an incident of war provoked by Peru.
He's very shocked and surprised because they were doing the, they were doing the regular walks on their border, and surprisingly enough, they found that the mines are in our territory.
Members of the group offer their help, even though they were not prepared for this.
We were just expecting to see the local people, but it's something, it's a surprise actually. Yeah, it's very surprising. Yeah. I hope we can help them. We're going to try to help him.
Shock trauma anesthesiologist Kevin Gerald is asked by the Ecuadorian doctors to lend a hand. This is a scene very familiar to him, only in Baltimore, landmines are replaced by bullets. He offers morphine to kill the pain.
The question came is, you know, how much can you do in this environment? What resource, the resources you have versus the resources you've brought with you? And he's kind of wait and see.
The young private is very fortunate to be surrounded by a group of very capable doctors who do everything they can to help him. He later undergoes surgery.
He's very stable, fortunately, very stable. He had an isolated injury where he lost his foot. His left foot was blown off. Didn't look like he lost a lot of blood.
Why? All they do is hurt people. They're one of the most vicious.
Well, trauma is man's inhumanity to man. See it every day in Baltimore.
40 years ago, this act of kindness and generosity would not have been as well received by a tribe deep in the isolated Ecuadorian jungle, in a village called Tanyampari. The Amazon is a mysterious rainforest where plants and people flourish. It is a place where life is given, and life is taken away. There are many tribes of Indians in Ecuador. They live in peaceful remote villages, accessible only by air. But they were not always a peaceful people. Once outsiders came to help, and they lost their lives trying. The year was 1956. Nate Saint and four other missionaries ventured into the jungle to make contact with the Auca Indians. Auca, meaning savage. It would be their last act of kindness. When the group arrived in the village, they were attacked with spears and killed by the Aucas. In the years to follow, Nate Saint's sister, Rachel, would come back to help the tribe learn to be compassionate and friendly. And that they are. She would teach them Christianity. And she would befriend Dayuma, who is now the leader of the tribe and the keeper of peace.
She's a very important woman because what she did is when she came back here to the communities, she talked to the rest of the tribes and she preached that we should not kill each other, we should not fight, because otherwise they were going to be extinguished. So little by little she worked, and now all these communities, they live in peace and they're able to survive and they live among themselves in peace.
After spending decades educating and caring for the Waranaris, Rachel died last year of natural causes. She is buried in the village center in the shadow of a plaque honoring the fallen martyrs, including her brother, whose mission she completed. After conversing with the tribe members, it is discovered the elder tribesman is the warrior who gave the orders to kill the missionaries. It is believed he feared all whites and considered them cannibals.
Sí. Él ahora es muy pacífico. Yes.
He is now a peaceful man and no longer believes in bloodshed, although he does voice his concerns about our visit. He talks of promises made by previous visitors who assured the Waranaris medical help would soon arrive, and no one ever came back. This angers him. Tammy vows to send back a plane with doctors on board. As we leave the village, Tammy makes arrangements with the army for a return trip to Tanyampari. this time with medical help to examine and treat some of the tribe's people. It is a promise kept.
Mending broken hearts, fixing broken smiles will continue. You're watching a Fox 45 News special, Mending Broken Hearts, Fixing Broken Smiles.
5 days of grueling work has come and gone. Now the healing begins. And a toy can go a long way in bringing a smile to the surface.
¿Cómo estás, bien? Sí, he just had his palate done. He didn't have his lip. Certainly could have had his lip redone, but the priority was his speech. You couldn't understand him at all. So, abra su boca, por favor.
The volunteers feel satisfied they have done their best.
I always get a big sense of accomplishment, and I take it on as a challenge. I take great pleasure in seeing the folks who get operated on, their families, their parents, and the happiness in their lives. And we have so much in the United States we take for granted. We have so many opportunities, so many resources that don't exist here. Take so much for granted. I learned to appreciate what I have.
For the patients, the operations will mean breathing and eating better. A better quality of life awaits them. Those who have passed through the doors here are better educated about their health. And the Ecuadent volunteers feel that knowledge will give them a fighting chance. Now it's time for goodbyes. It is the hope of the Ecuadorian people that developed nations of the world will look to this country with a spirit of greater understanding. The country's leaders hope international cooperation will bring them out of the stagnation they are experiencing. As is often the case in third world countries, underdevelopment has a crippling effect. But through the efforts of groups like Ecuadent, small gaps are bridged. This is the groundwork on the road to fixing broken smiles. In the past 5 days, the Ecuadent dental team has treated over 1,000 patients, turning very few away. And the medical portion of the group, they saw over 40 patients. But for every one person they made smile, there was another Ecuadorian in need of medical attention they had to turn away. Plans for a return trip to Ecuador have already begun. And next time, they hope they don't have to turn anyone away in need of a new smile. In Puyo, Ecuador, I'm Lisa Willis. Thanks for watching.
This has been a Fox 45 News special.